Howdy, everyone who are joined us for the workshop, IEEE Safety Security Rescue Robotics Workshop on Unmanned Marine Vehicles. We're, you know, as typical with the workshop, we're a couple of minutes behind, but we're going to keep this going, and you'll probably see us do some editing, moving presentations, but we'll be with you shortly. Okay, we're getting closer, but just a couple more minutes. Let's see if you've got any videos. We had a problem with video showing up. There's a video.
Yeah, this one.
Yeah. Nope.
No.
So if you can bring over your videos, then we can do a screen share shift over to. I'll advance your slides and when we get to video, I'll go screen share the video. Yeah, that's the problem we saw. Okay, so. And we try to, we've tried different versions of PowerPoint and things like that. Why don't we keep the lights up a little bit more, we can see each other.
So we're getting closer to our online audience.
So who here has never worked with an unmanned marine vehicle? Raise your hand. Wow, a little more than half. So you've not done anything with water robots. Wow, so this is going to be what the different challenges are associated with water robots. Very cool. And all right, so we'll just go over the agenda while we're waiting as we get our few setup going. The agenda today, the whole purpose of this is really to start thinking about water-based vehicles and marine vehicles, particularly in the context of disasters. So we'll start off I'll give a talk on UMVs for disasters, particularly for mass marine casualties. Dr. Bayat will talk about more specifics of some of the details where, you know, acoustics are so important for the underwater component. Then we have some short invited talks. As you see here, Sandeep Manjanna from McGill is talking about path planning. They've done some nice stuff with coral reefs. Dr. Eleni, Kelasidi will be talking about underwater snake robots. So I know how many ground robot people, you know, snakes, it should kind of relate. And then Jan Dufek, one of my graduate students, will be talking about visual navigation of a surface vehicle, marine surface vehicle from a UAV. Then we'll go to some posters, coffee break, posters, and then get down to the business of what does it take? What are the research challenges and roadmaps? What are the things that we need to be doing as a community and starting to focus? What are the hard problems? What are the problems that may have already been solved that either need to be transferred to marine vehicles or from marine vehicles already working on that and we didn't know it was there, but there's some newer challenge that is unique to working with water-based systems. And so that's where we come in. We'll break into three breakout groups and then meet back and discuss what we're seeing as the big pictures there. So what are the hard problems? So right now what we're waiting for is Dr. Bayat to get his videos, and if Sandeep Manjanna is here, if we could get a thumb drive with your presentation so that you can present from my laptop, because we believe screen sharing, we have proof that that works from my laptop. We've not been able to make some of the invitations and things work to share computers. Yeah, my name's Murphy, Robin Murphy, and so Murphy's Law, which I believe is universal, applies. Whenever I touch technology, something goes wrong.
I have my slides on my uncle's slide. I have some videos on that.
Right, you need to bring the videos. Please put this in a file on this. You'll have to run it from here. We cannot swap.
Okay.
We cannot swap.
I'll try to.
Thanks.
A screenshot of my confirmation sent to you in a.
Great. All right, well, we're. So in theory, if anyone's at the link, they should have been able to see this. But let's go ahead and start, let's see, screen sharing. Just to keep it on track, and it's always fun to watch people deal with thumb drives. So let's go ahead and get started. And nope, that wasn't what I wanted to do. All right. But that was an interesting effect, wasn't it? Very, very interesting. There it is. That's the one. Did I mention that part about Murphy's Law? All right, so if anybody's looking at the YouTube videos, they should be able to see the presentation entitled Unmanned Marine and Aerial Vehicles for Mass Marine Casualty. Oop. What just happened there? That's not correct. There we go. All right. So potential, I started in the center of my slides. All right, so my talk, it's kind of as it was going to be an overview of unmanned marine vehicles for disasters. It's really going to focus more on the potential use of unmanned marine vehicles for disasters and some of the research issues that I have seen from our work with that. And of course, some examples of marine disasters. We have the Syrian and North African boat refugees, Costa Concordia, you know, very dramatic, as well as the Seawall ferry in South Korea. And the United States, we've had two bridge collapses happen. And that's considered a marine disaster because of all the people in the water. And then in Britain, the Fastnet sailing disaster, very different, where you have yachts of people spread out over 300 kilometers. So that adds a very different flavor than something like a ferry or a cruise ship where it's all localized. And then, of course, we've got marine disasters can come from flooding. We saw so many deaths from drowning from the tsunamis and from storm surges. So what I wanted to do today in my talk is just talk a little bit about CRASAR and what we do and why, what motivates this talk. What's the definition of a mass marine casualty event? What does that mean? And when we talk about lifeguards, okay, it's not showing the right thing. Okay, when we talk about lifeguards, who are they and what are they doing? And we've got to go back and fix the YouTube part. So it's screen share. Let's go to stop. So that seems like we need to go to the entire screen if we want to get the presenter. So good call. Thanks. Share. And how's it showing up on there? Oh, that's looking better. It's a little bit behind the time, but that's good. All right. Thank you. All right. So who are the lifeguards? When we talk about lifeguards, what does that mean? What do they do? How do they do it? What are the tools that they are currently using now? And are there any aspects about mass marine casualty disasters beyond that immediate life-saving, saving lives? And then what are the possible uses of unmanned systems, especially marine vehicles, plus the associated research questions? And so just as a caveat, this talk is more of a preliminary work analysis than a literature review or history of deployment, so I apologize if I don't refer to all the great work that is currently going on or has been done, and that's part of my motivation for being one of the sponsors of this workshop is to learn from you on what's being done. So there's tremendous work being done. You know, the Nifty project did some lovely work. Researchers in Spain and Portugal have done some very interesting work with thermal. So all part of this. All right, just for terminology. So since half of you have not worked with marine vehicles, there are just all kind of abbreviations. Unmanned marine vehicle, UMV, let's think of that as the universal set of all unmanned vehicles that work in the water. USV are going to be the subset that work on the surface of the water. So those are the boats. Underwater vehicles are the ones that aren't boats. And those fall into two categories. ROVs, which are the tethered underwater robots, and those have historically been called ROVs, remotely operated vehicles. And the ones that are underwater and are not tethered have been called autonomous underwater vehicles, even though they have very little autonomy. So we'll be using those terms. Now, about CRASAR, about the Center for Robot-Assisted Search and Rescue, we conduct our research is primarily field research. So we try to integrate into disaster managers and the practitioners both through actual going to disasters and through what we call summer institutes and through our field exercises. So the idea is that if you can have practice feeds into the research and drives fundamental research questions, helps identify them, and the research then gets transitioned into practice and it builds a cycle. So we, for the past 2 years, we worked on flooding, and then this last year and this coming year, our two-year focus will be on mass marine casualty events. And so to start with, I want to oh, great. I've got the same problem as everybody else. None of this stuff is showing up in there. All right. So let me show you what this this type of robot. And wow, this is really bad. Stop screen sharing. When I checked, these had actually run this morning, but apparently not so much. Okay, even better when I can't even find the screen that it's on. So I'm going to go back and try this again. Well, I'm really sorry. All right, let's look at that. All right, so you're seeing the Emily robot. It's a surface vehicle that we've been working with. It's been around since 2010, and you can see it can, its flotation device. It's basically a miniature jet ski with a flotation device, so you can hang up to 5 people off of it. But it also has two-way audio, a video camera on there, so you can use it to follow, to see proactively. Lifeguards like to see what's going on and anticipate problems. It can also, you can attach a line to it, run it off to a group that's stuck on the water. And so that was what we did in Greece. We deployed to Greece for the boat crisis there in January. Since then, let's get back to screen that. Since then, in February, we left 2 of them, one with the Coast Guard, the Hellenic Coast Guard, and one with the Hellenic American Red Cross. And the Hellenic Coast Guard used it to save a boatload of refugees that got washed on a rocky shore with the waves. They could not get to them themselves. They used this to send a line out to them and then ferry them back and forth and got the entire group off of. And the waves were so bad that eventually one of the Greek sailors fell into the water. And the captain went in and had to rescue the sailor, so he got injured doing that. Okay, so I assume this one's not going to work either. Yay, team. So let's go for that. All right, so this is some work, and one of the advantages that we have is that we've been, let's see if we can actually. Work and play it. All right, there we go. So we were fortunate to work with the Italian Coast Guard, who's been, of course, working at Lampedusa with the North African boat refugees. And that's interesting because whereas in Greece you were seeing boatloads of about 40 to 50 people, now you're seeing boatloads of 800 people because it's a larger distance to go across. With them, we were experimenting with some of the lessons learned from working with the Greek in Greece and how to make things better. So here's an example of using a tethered UAV, which, because it's not GPS-based, will follow the boat, the vessel, will just follow based on the tether. And so if the boat drifts or they have to steer a little bit, it doesn't cause a problem. Here, running a line out, the flotation, what they've learned is that if you have the flotation device out there, the jet ski doesn't have enough power to bring a couple of people back, and it kind of wallows, so it's better to pull them back with a line. And of course, the hitting a person with a boat, it won't hurt them, the shape of the hull and such, but it doesn't make them happy. But the operator doesn't have any depth perception, so they typically either get too far away or are too close. And you see them bringing that back in, the view from the photo kite. In there. All right, so that gives a little bit of an idea of what we're doing. Screen share and go back. All And so what would be a mass marine casualty event? And so there's no real hard and fast definition of this. So one way to think about it is that intuitively we think about it in terms of life saving and victim recovery. And victim recovery, it's not showing that it changed it. Victim recovery is going to be once they've drowned. You know, and that's a big problem. And so that's a problem with castaways as well. So let's see if we can get the right. And I'll get back to that. Thank you for your patience with this AV torture. So the mass marine casualty, you can think of it when the number of people exceeds the number of lifeguards, what the lifeguards can normally handle. So for routine lifeguarding, it's about 1-to-1. You think about a lifeguard at a beach. One, maybe two people may be heading toward a riptide or need help. Not usually 20 or 30 people at one time, right? Likewise, if you've got a boat goes down, somebody has their power boat and it flips or something, that's 3 or 4 people. And then you maybe have 2 lifeguards. So it's the ratio's always been that. So when you look at the Greeks in the Greek boat thing, the refugees, the ratio was about 13-to-1. The number of lifeguards you had on a rescue vessel, either with the Coast Guard or one of the NGOs, was 13-to-1. So they're really overwhelmed. That really changes up what you have to do. And that's something you very rarely have. Same thing, it was more like, I think I looked at the way the statistics were showing as closer to like 45-to-70-to-1 for the seawall, the Korean ferry disaster for the first groups on site. They got there quickly, but the ratios just weren't in their favor. And so another part of that is when you say people at risk, and there are 2 ways that lifeguards, from what I can tell, determine what's at risk. So people in water can be at risk, and that's a very reactive. Once they're in the water, you've got about 15 minutes to get them out of the water before they've drowned, unless they're in life jackets and cool and calm and collected. And the people in the water, they can be fine, but they can also be in distress. They can be freaking out. They can be drowning. They can be unconscious, and then you've got whether you're face up or face down. And then as they begin to drown, they begin to submerge, which makes it very hard to find them and track them. And that becomes a very, very terrible problem in and of itself. Another way to look at this is that people at risk can also be proactive. Are they fixing to get in danger? So at risk is, are they fixing to go into water? So is the vessel sinking and they're not in the water yet, but we need to get them off? Are they stuck on the rocks and eventually will be at high risk of drowning? So both think about that as you think about both the risk is in the water, but also proactively preventing things from getting worse. So let's shift to who are the lifeguards, what they do, how they do it, and with what. So with lifeguards, typically you think of them, they're usually associated as a formal authority, like your Coast Guard, Frontex, your regional harbor and beach patrols. They're trained, they have a mandate, they have a legal requirements, public accountability. Then there's sometimes in a mass marine casualty, though, it's what is ad hoc responders. So in the United States, it's VFH radio 16. There's similar frequencies for maritime disasters. We can do a mayday. So if you've got something like the Costa Concordia or a ferry boat or some major event, then you have everyone with the boat, everyone who is nearby within hailing frequency is obligated to come over. So that's fishing boats, people who were out with their family, skiing, whatever, all have to go over. So that's it. What's unusual is with the boat immigration that we're having in Europe is having the large number of non-governmental organizations get involved. Okay, and these non-governmental organizations like Pro-Aid and Pro-EM, they're lifeguard teams from all over the world coming over to help. So they are volunteers, but we're working for beach patrol in one of the resorts, like in Majorca or something, and now are taking their time off to come and help. And that there's, so they're, they have the experience of a formal authority and some of the equipment, but it's not clear what their role is. In the United States, we had boat immigration coming over from Cuba, but the Coast Guard was very, only the Coast Guard would get in the middle of it. Here with that. So in lifeguarding, there seems to be three specializations. You are either beach, harbor, which is, you think of just basic boating, and then swift water, which is rivers are next to the surf and that. So we'll go in more detail about that. So in beach rescue, UMVs and boats and jet skis are really common. The idea is that you're on the beach, the lifeguard is on the beach. Their job is to make sure that the at-risk people don't get into risk. Stay away from the riptide. If they get in a riptide or start drowning, the first thing you do is get them flotation, and then you worry about getting a boat or something there to get them out of the water, but mostly try to stabilize. Okay, and so they use jet skis. Jet skis are very fast, but if you're going from the shore, it turns out the lifeguards are now seeing a high incidence of knee and back injuries from stress of using the jet skis and going over the surf to get out from the shore to there. And sometimes they have jet skis that are out just on patrol, so they don't have to take that. And Emily was originally developed for that. You can also swim or wade out, but that's of course slower. Now, swift water is when you have a flood and a river, and that person tried to drive their car across the road, and now they're swept down and they're stuck on their car and they need help, or they've been camping and they're hanging onto a tree or something. So usually it's much more a confined space. The water, the current is a big problem. And the strategy is generally trying to get a line to them to pull them out, or flotation for them to haul them out. And a lot of times you can't get a helicopter into these areas to do the rescue, and it's very hard to get a boat, and you can't really swim. So now if you've got wind, you're thinking about, how am I throwing stuff over to them? How do I get lines to them and gear? One way to do it is to throw ropes, and then of course that requires, you know, a lot of skill and luck. And then there's these rope guns. And the rope guns is, again, another skill set of trying to get it over to the person, not hit the person, because if you hit them, it's a pretty hard hit. And so that swift water is another area. Harbor is the open area. Generally, the rescue boat has access. The trick is often the bigger boats is them getting there fast enough to make a difference. Okay, and there's usually less of those. I mean, that was a big problem with the Hellenic Coast Guard. They only had a couple of patrol boats to cover that whole area, and the Coast Guard already had a full-time job. So the boat immigrants added to that too. And the strategies are about the combination of beach and swift water. You want to try to keep up and see if this boat's going to get in trouble. You want to get flotation to them and get them off. Now, if you have a vessel go down, typically you may want to call in a dive team to check it out. We'll talk more about that. And once you have a mass drowning, you may use side scan sonar or something to try to find the submerged bodies before they drift too far away and can't be recovered. So other aspects beyond immediate life saving. Well, there are five other aspects, and one is critical infrastructure. So not only are you worried about life saving, but the formal authorities are often worried about the critical infrastructure. A classic is that vessel going to sink and impact critical infrastructure? So is it going down like that, a ferry? Is it taking also, besides the terrible loss of life, has it shut down that shipping channel? How quickly can we get it fixed? So one thing is if a vessel is leaking or damaged, they send in dive teams, or they wish they could send in dive teams to figure out, can I stabilize it now, fix it? How bad's it going to be? Can I tow it away? And if it's submerged, how long is it going to take to get out of there? A second aspect is environment. What is the environmental impact of this marine event? Is the vessel leaking hazardous material? Is it leaking sewage? Can the leaks be quickly repaired. So in the case of Texas, we're very worried about, not so much about cruise ships, although that, you know, something like Concordia, we have so much shipping of petrochemicals. A lot of those specialty petrochemicals are highly acidic. So that gets into a real question as to what's that doing to the environment and what's that doing to the people. Another aspect of that is it just even leaking diesel and gas can hurt the environment quite a bit, and also can coat the people who you're rescuing, and they need to be decontaminated before they get to a hospital, or once they're at the hospital, or they contaminate the hospital. And that gets into medical. So the medical teams often have no way of knowing what's going on, who's going to be delivered to their doorstep, and in what condition. And so another aspect of unmanned systems for marine disasters is, can we coordinate with the medical aspects like the ambulances? So they want to know how many to expect of injured, how bad will it be, will they need decontamination, and where are they being dropped off of? So you can imagine if there's a Channel 14 Mayday and somebody in a fishing boat picks up some people, and they're just going to drop them off at their dock, where they come into port in general, where they park the boat. How does the ambulance know to get there, to pick those people up from there? And likewise, if it were on our little boat, our little pleasure boat, where would we take them? We would not know that if it's in Galveston, we should take them over to the University of Texas Memorial Hospital. So this becomes a huge problem for the medical people. And then it turns out for us, especially in the United States, but I believe it's also true here and in Europe and Asia, homeland security, was that an accident? And then there was the question of any regulations. So if you have any type of accident now in the United States, they always call in homeland security investigations to determine if it was an accident versus terrorism. And after for us, the Cole, the USS Cole, where a small boat attacked and damaged a large fleet vessel, you can't even say, well, it's a small personal boat, so therefore it's not terrorism. It could very well be. I mean, you know, our assumption in the United States up until the USS Cole, anytime you had a small boat involved, it was somebody who had drank too much Texas beer. But that's not true. Another problem you have is that if you have so imagine something like the Costa Concordia, if it happens, what are all those people, what is their immigration status? Where are their passports? Are they supposed to be there? Likewise, if you have something with a cargo crew, many times the ship's crew do not have authorizations to be in that particular country and their passports. So the border security has to come in and play and figure out what's going on as well. So it becomes important to track people. It's all together, some possible uses of unmanned systems and informatics, that larger things. Let me show you some of the things that I'm seeing. And of course, part of this workshop is to work on more. So certainly one of the goals is to decrease the time and effort it takes to reach people that are at risk, but at the same time, increasing the effective person to lifeguard ratio. So we really can't put more lifeguards on the boat or more robot people. There's not room on the boat. So how do we do that? And so the purpose, of course, is to get them flotation or a line, and the purpose is also for them to proactively monitor the situation. And so some of the research questions are, well, it's great to have a robot. How long does it take to set it up? Are you diverting lifeguard manpower to control or supervise any robots? Do they trust it? Are there any hidden manpower costs? Like now everybody has to spend a lot more time in training and such, and that's not budgeted into their things. And how would you use multiple robots? If one robot's good, wouldn't multiple robots be better? How are we gonna do that? Certainly having UAVs has an opportunity of shared situation awareness. You can think of sharing back. Projection of victim risk, so that we saw the lifeguards at Greece loved being able to circle around a refugee boat so they could see what the condition was, if anybody was obviously shivering from hypothermia, if there were problems, if anything was leaking, any signs of things. Planning coordination of resources. How bad is it? The Coast Guard headquarters in the United States would love to have an aerial view so they can see, is this a big one, or will the people on site have it under control? Do we need to divert more? And then also for accident investigation and documentation, you want to immediately have start time stamping what's going on. You don't want photographs 2 hours later because you can't really confirm what was the actual cause. And of course, the medical people want to just see what the heck is going on. How bad is it? So that gets to the idea of, well, if you're flying a UAV, what's the right viewpoint? What's the right altitude? Is it cameras? Are you using thermal at all? How long do you need to fly? If you have communication, is it bidirectional, or do you have everybody back on shore gets to see, but they're not telling anybody what to do or trying to direct the robots? What are the direct and hidden manpower costs? Do you want to have UAVs flying over people and vessels? Is there a problem there? And again, multiple robots. And with the photokite, they really like the photokite, but you also have to keep in mind they have to position the boat a certain way. Otherwise, there's a chance that the gust will put it into the rigging, to the mast. So that changes up their procedures. Seems to be acceptable, but not something you would think about normally. You've got to make it work. So another goal would be to track people from the point of the incident to where they were actually picked up and released. How many people were in the water? Did you find them all? Typically, if you ask somebody how many people were with you, the numbers vary, so you can't get a good count of how many people you should be looking for. Okay, were any swept away? Who was picked up? Where were they going? And then if we've lost people and they're submerged, what's the current things looking like? And so that again gets back into sensors, the ability to use computer vision. How do you manage the uncertainty, positional recognition, integration of current wave and search models that already exist? Can you do any kind of tagging of people? This person's not in distress, this person is. How would you do it? How do you visualize this? This becomes a big one, because particularly since you're talking about over a large period of time, because it could take hours before you find out that this person's released from the hospital, particularly if there's someone who's not supposed to be in the United States. You want to keep up with that. How would you show that to anybody? Another aspect is underwater inspection and repair. You want to see, is this vessel leaking really bad? Do I have to get everybody off now? Can I tow it back? What's the status? Can I get this sunken vessel out of the ship channel? Can I fix the leak? How much is it going to cost? And then also gets into tracking. Sometimes they've had cargo start just floating away. So in the middle of the life saving, you've got another group of people that are like, can you track that as well? Because it's a really expensive cargo. So with underwater inspection and repair, you see with this idea of having SLAM becomes important, underwater SLAM, the ability to do underwater manipulation to fix anything. And again, that visualization, what's the state? And of course, water-based sampling and perhaps visual assessment of those water-based sampling. What's in the water? Is it diesel? Is it hydrofluoric acid? What's in there? And so the medical people need to know that. And also we need to know that as well, as to how do you mitigate any downstream consequences. And that gets into that, what sensors would you use? Do you need those to be on board sampling and then basically radio, what the is? Or are you going to take the physical sample and then bring it back to somebody to analyze? Is there any particular pattern in the way that you sample over that distance, over the water and with waves and wind? Again, computer vision, can you tell a nice shiny oil slick kind of indicates an oil slick, that it's a, it's a thing. Is that sufficient? And how do you integrate this in with the plume modeling within the sophisticated things? So today, I think what we want to do is create a more complete and explicit list of the challenges and possibilities and try to work toward our R&D roadmap. And so that's the real goal here. Although it seems part of our goal will be to stress the Google Hangouts new on-stream live system. and test all of our patients in this. But I think it'll be a very worthwhile workshop, and I look forward to this. And on behalf of myself and my students and my colleagues at Texas A&M, we'd love for you to come and participate in our 2017 Summer Institute, which will be held in Galveston, which is basically the island south of Houston. So for all practical purposes, it's Houston. And we'll be setting the dates really soon. So that concludes my talk in the introduction. Let's see if we can stop the screen sharing. All right, so we've stopped the screen sharing. Any quick questions? Okay. Any quick questions before we go to our next speaker? Aki?
Great talk, Robin. Thanks. Maybe just a question about conditions for mobility, like big winds, big currents. What would be the limit where you see, we always employ our platforms, but there be conditions where it's just too hard for, especially for quadrupters, it seems like photokite, I guess, if the winds are very strong, how well can it go?
Well, the photokite, they've told us, oh, it just kind of goes this way on the, you know, if you've got a tether on the wind. We certainly we see winds that exceed the ratings for quadcopters. And you've got to think about that in terms of both quad and fixed wing. And what's the right altitude? Are you just popping up for 15 minutes, or are you trying to get a bigger thing? Waves are a big problem as well. Waves, wind, but that often means, so the more extreme conditions are the conditions in which the lifeguards themselves do not work well. They can't get there. They can't get one of those inflatable rigid boats that are commonly used. They can't get those over there to the people because of the waves. And so that's really when they need the technology. So it's a big opportunity. But of course, trying to do control in waves is very difficult. Trying to do a straight line, you're getting buffeted, and you've got a wind effect. So the waves are trying to drive your robot, a surface vehicle one way, your wind's trying to do another. If you've worked with underwater vehicles, current is a huge problem. There's a lot of cases with autonomous underwater vehicles think that they're going forward, but in fact they're actually going backwards. And so there's been some advances in Doppler radar bouncing against the bottom that hopefully has enough pattern that they can see, oh no, we're not actually moving forward. So it's a big deal. The environment is, out of all the environments I've worked in, aerial, ground, and marine, the marine environment is by far the most challenging. But it may be the one that's the most in the long run, even though ground robots have been around forever, aerial vehicles are very sexy, marine vehicles may be the most important, most valuable to us as a society.
Rescuers with, like, if they have technology that they can only deploy 50% of the cases, will they still take it with them, or where? Yeah, where is the threshold of usability that they would take it with them?
You know, we don't know. We haven't seen that, and we also see. So, for instance, take the Emily system, that's been commercially available since 2010. And it's been used, at least 10, 12 countries use it. Lifeguards either love it or hate it. You know, they either, it's, and we can't really tell what that threshold is. The Italian Coast Guard did not like it. They felt that it was adding to their manpower demands. It was one more thing to do. It was taking too much time, a little, was going to distract them. The Hellenic Coast Guard was, give me more. We love these. These are easy to use. We like them. And they're talking about the exact same missions. So that's where I think, again, an open research question becomes in the human factors, the usability from the users, the operators, can we reduce that load on them? I think one of the things that the Italian Coast Guard didn't like is that there's, as with wireless, you just don't know when it's going to go out. And so the system on the wireless did not have an automatic return to home function. And that's a big problem. So trust is a big issue. Do I trust this thing to get out here? Particularly if I'm going to have a scenario where we could see as smart researchers, we'll make it autonomous, we'll somehow circle people in an aerial view and have the robot zoom over there while we go jump in to help the person who's actively drowning. Go stabilize those people over there, but get them flotation. Let's go to the ones that are the highest at risk and prioritize. But if I, the lifeguard, turn my back on that, do I trust it to get over there? Do I trust it to do the right thing? Do I trust it not to run out of battery power? Do I trust, you know? And so we see that as a problem, you know. Great. All right, well, let's go to the next presentation. And now we're going to shift to the more technical aspect and really talk about the unique aspects of marine robots for search and rescue. And Dr. Bayat from here from EPFL is going to be giving that talk. And we're going to go into yet another challenge with our audiovisual. So and you've got your so let me show you what we're doing here. Get there, and then on this window here over there we've got the screen share.
Yeah,
and then you pick which one and you have to do the entire screen, but then you'll have to switch over to your videos when you get to that.
Okay.
But that should bring up, now everybody should see your, that they should see that on, yes, on your.
Yeah, it's coming down. It's your inputs.
Yes. Okay, great. Perfect. And then you'll screen share just.
Yeah. Okay, thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. So, thank you for the introduction. So, I'm Behzad Bayat, and this is the work that I did in collaboration with UNET and DSR from Technical Lisbon. Most of the part is the work that I did when I was back there, and some of it is the collaboration I did when I moved to EPFL. So I'm going to talk about role of acoustic-based methods in UMVs. And to start with, let's look at the acoustic positioning systems. We have the main reason we go for acoustic positioning system is that we don't have GPS underwater because the electromagnetic signals do not penetrate very well underwater. And we want to avoid using inertial-based systems because they're quite costly. It's used in military, but the cost is not so justified if you use it for applications in commercial products. And so the industry has gone towards using different methods based on acoustics, like long and short and ultra-short baseline systems. And even something close to the GPS system, but for underwater, like GPS-aided buoys. Which, in general, what these systems do is that they get a range from a vehicle or from a beacon to the target. And from the time difference of arrival or the round time of arrival, they get the ranges and using trilateration or even using the bearings and triangulation, they can find the location of the target or the vehicle. But some of these methods, like for example, the Jeep system is quite costly. And as I go on, I would try to also take a look at alternatives that could be less costly and it would require less maintenance for an operator to use. So I would try to divide this in two class of problems. There is the vehicle positioning and target localization. These two are quite close to each other. It's just looking to the problem from a different perspective. So by vehicle positioning, we mean that we try to find the information on the vehicle, get the sensory information or even the information from the acoustic link, and try to fuse that data to find the position of the vehicle in the environment.
But on the contrary, we also have the underwater target localization, which is you have a target underwater. It could be a beacon, it could be a fish or another vehicle, and you want to find the information about the location of that target based on the information you get. Like, it could be like ranges or bearings, or even if you have the luxury of having an acoustic link to that beacon. So for going through these problems, I would go through like two case scenarios, two applications, and then at the end I would go through a little bit more theoretical point of view, and then see some proof of concept from some experiments. So to begin with, I start with diver assistance scenario. So this was a part of the EU project Co3 AUVs, which was in collaboration with many European institutes. And the whole vision was to have a guiding system, a fleet of vehicles underwater. And these vehicles are going to guide a human diver under the water to go to specific waypoints. So you could even look at this as a GPS system for underwater, but it's configurable, so we can move the vehicles around, and then we can also tell the vehicles to follow the diver and help it to localize itself and even guide it to a specific location. So the key components in this system is a fleet of vehicles where the Medusa vehicles from ISD were used. And the main key component is also the acoustic network where the Tritech modems were used. In this case, one of the vehicles, which is the master here, the red one, sends a ping command to the diver. The diver has a specific unit which is going to reply to this ping, and even add more information from the status of the diver, and then send back a reply. From the time of going back and forth the signal, then we get the ranges, we can do a trial iteration, and then find the location of the diver. So this is what the diver assistant unit look like. So it is composed of a microprocessor attitude unit. So it would send the information of where the diver is heading. And there is an acoustic model for the communication link. And it's also used for ranging device. And on top of this, there is the goggles which the diver is going to wear. So this goggle, since it has an LED array, it's going to help the diver to how much steer left or right, depending on the action it takes from the surface vehicles. So this is what you can see is like three different case scenarios in different days and different, let's say, weather conditions. And you can see that the data could be quite different in different scenarios. Like on the left, on the top left, you can see that we have quite a lot of misses, like 50% of the misses, while you could see in another day, bottom down, on the left, there is like just 5% of misses. So the acoustic conditions are going to vary from day to day, and you have to have a robust systems that can even work if you're missing half of the information. So based on this, what we did was try to find and estimate the location of the diver in between even the misses, and also design a robust algorithm that is going to reject outliers that you could get under the water. I would just switch to the video. Sorry. I think, yeah, it is.
Over to the left.
Here?
Yeah, but you've
got to
do the stops. You've
got to
go to the screen
here. So I would stop this one.
Go over to the left. Mm-hmm. And you can pick green arrow on the left of the Google. And then you can pick which screen you want.
Okay, I would first open the video here.
Screen share.
Okay, so So this is what it looked like at the end. That in the beginning, the three vehicles are going to stop and try to find the location. Then after they get a fix, they start moving. And you can see that the green one is what the green dot is what we are getting from a GPS, because the diver was moving, but we had like a buoy at the surface to know exactly where it is going. But it was just used for ground truthing. And then we have the cyan track, which is the estimated location of the diver. And based on that, we were using this information to feedback to the diver what it should do. So this is what I'm presenting is just the navigation part of the work. But then on top of this is going to be formation control for the surface vehicles and even navigation command, which is going to be sent to the diver. So if you, okay, I will switch back to the screen. Okay, so this is what it looked like at the end, that we wanted to follow a U mission, and then what the diver was describing at that time was that I couldn't see anything. The only thing I was seeing is that there were just some red and green LEDs to go left or right, and at the end he managed to finish the mission. And if you want to know more information, you can look at the publication. Then the second scenario is a sensor-based localization for autonomous underwater vehicles. This was part of the MORF project, which was another European project with institutions all around Europe. So in this case, there is a fleet of five vehicles under the water, one at the surface, two in the upper level, and another two in the lower level. And these whole vehicles, they're going to form a supra vehicle, which depending on the scenario, they're going to move from one point to another point, change the formation, and reconfigure the formation depending on the task that they should do. But the key question in this scenario for me, it was that, first of all, we have to know where the vehicles are. And then on top of that, we do the control and other specific tasks. So this is what we had in that time. So you have a flow of information on each vehicle. So the surface vehicle has the GPS, so it can know its position and estimate the velocities and the heading that it's going. So it's going to pass out that information to the underwater vehicle of the upper level. And since we had also an ultrashot baseline there, we could find the location of the two upper vehicles relative to the surface vehicle. But this was happening every 5 to 10 seconds. And in between, we had to have an estimator to find the locations in between to do some control scenarios, which requires at least one sample, one hertz frequency. And then we have the lower level, which is only receiving the information from the upper level. And on top of that, it receives the range information. So it has to do some local control and local navigation based on only the ranges that it gets. But if we put the range information from the lower level vehicles together, we can do the same as trilateration and find the location of the lower levels. So in terms of estimator design, it's going to be the same thing for all the other vehicles. So the leader estimates its position and velocities from GPS data. It broadcasts to the upper level. Then the followers, they estimate the speed in between the broadcast, and they use the information they get from the positioning system to estimate the current and the relative position to the target. So this information is going to be passed to the formation controller to do the whole formation control. So after we did all this together in simulation, we saw that it was working really fine. And we moved to doing so many trials at sea, which the last one was in Azores, off coast of Portugal. And this is actually the result that happened with five whales going in water untethered without using any other information apart from the information you get from acoustics. And I cannot go into more details a bit of this, but if you want more information, you can look at the publications in the Oceans and the NGCUV conference, and you can find all the information that you can, that you need. But now I would get to the more interesting part from my own perspective, which is range-only localization. So up to here, what I talked was about using ranges from multiple vehicles or even using range and bearings. And then based on that, yeah, you even at a single snapshot, since you have a lot of information, at least three ranges from three vehicles, then you can find the location of the either the vehicle or the target up to some certainty. But what if you have only one beacon? What can you do with that? So to answer this, we went to the basics, to observability. So first of all, we have to look even if this problem is observable. If you have just one beacon, what can you do? What's the accuracy that you can get? And if you look at the public at the literature, the paper published in 1977 for nonlinear observability of a system, since our system is it gets range measurement, it is a nonlinear system in terms of output model. So you have a system with some inputs, and then you're just out looking at the output. And then from this, can you say what is the initial state of the system? If you can define the initial state of the system uniquely, then you can say that, okay, my system is observable, and I can design an estimator to find the initial location of the vehicle. Then, so the concrete definition is that if you have a pool of inputs for your system and you can find at least one input that will yield two different outputs, then your system is observable. And in another sense, if you can find the same scenario but in a local region, that would imply local observability of the system. And one more interesting thing, which is it has the most importance here, is the universal inputs. So what I said is that you have a pool of inputs that you can apply, and you have to go through all of them. And if you find, if you can find one which would distinguish the initial state of the system, then it is observable. But what if you have just an input that can distinguish all the other initial state of the system? So no matter what is the initial state, then it can tell you, okay, I can give you the initial state if you just apply this input to the system. So this would be the definition of universal input. But so if I wanna tell you in more details, I would give you an example. For example, in the in this scenario that we are looking at, we have a beacon which is located at the origin, and then we get a range measurement, something like R0. Then the possibility is that our vehicle is gonna be on this circumference, on this circle. But if you take just two initial conditions, like X0 and Z0, and then you apply a constant yaw angle of psi, then the output of this system is gonna be the ranges starting, so it will be a trajectory going from this direction or this direction. These are the two hypotheses. And if you look at this, then the outputs are gonna be exactly the same. So X0 is not distinguishable from Z0 if we apply this psi. But if we slightly change this, we can see that the output here is not gonna be changed. This is gonna go way faster, far from the beacon, while this one is still first getting close and then going far from the beacon. So we can distinguish these two from each other by applying this input. So in a sense, this system is observable because we can find at least this input that would distinguish these two initial conditions. But what I'm looking for is that I want to apply one input that no matter what are the other possible initial conditions, then I can find the exact initial condition of the system. So that's why we went for some weaker notion of observability. Let's say that you don't restrict yourself for all the possible initially possible inputs to the system, but you define some class of inputs, and then in those class of inputs, you just look for universal inputs that's gonna make your system observable. There are some critical issues here. First is that scenario in this single beacon scenario, so the vehicle must move. So if the vehicle doesn't move, you always have a chance that the initial condition is on a circle. So you have to move to get information. That helps you to estimate the state you're looking for. And then when you move, then there is the motion dependency. So your accuracy is going to depend on what input you apply. And that's and then if you make a bad choice of input, that's going to influence your accuracy. And even in the worst case, it's going to make your system observable. Like what happened in the previous slide, that we chose psi, which made the system observable. So having said all this, I would just introduce a 2D single vehicle state model. It's a very simplistic kinematic model of the vehicle by a constant velocity v and a heading angle, which is defined by key. Then the vehicle is drifted by the current, which in most of the conditions, at least in a reasonable time window, you can consider the current constant. And then you have an output, just single output, which is the range measurement to the beacon. Without loss of generality, you can always consider that, okay, beacon is at the origin. Since it's not moving, we can just translate everything back to the origin. So by looking at this, we can investigate the 2D observability of the 2D observability problem. And from the motion dependence, we can see that, okay, I am gonna define two class of inputs. One is the class of inputs that will yield a straight line motion, and the other one is the circular motion. In the case of circular motion, everything is, the life is easy. We have observability. No matter what, if you don't have current, you have current that you don't know, or you have current that you have knowledge about it. So your system is observable. But in the straight line motion, if you don't know what is the current, the system is not locally weakly observable. So you cannot determine where did the system start from. But if you know what the current is, or if there is no current, you have a possibility of having two possible solutions. So, which I'm gonna show you in an example how it looks like. So the key result from here is that if you have constant non-zero relative course angle rate, this will yield to universal inputs. And if we go for the 3D case scenario, the straight line motion is going to fail definitely. But in the case of circular motion, we have some cases where the system is locally weakly observable, and in some other cases, it's not observable at all, where it is if you have unknown current. But the good news is that if you had the 3D case scenario, getting the depth measurement is really easy nowadays. You just put a pressure sensor and you can know the depth. From that, you can map the whole system to a 2D scenario. So this is an example of an experiment we did in the water. You have two beacons you can see as so these are the original location of the beacons, shown by red and cyan. And then we intentionally try to initialize the estimator from the wrong side, which is a mirror point on the right of the vehicle. As I told you, we investigated the observability. We know that there is going to be two solutions. The beacon is either on the right side of the vehicle or it's on the left. And if we initialize two estimators with one on the right, one on the left, and after a while, we can see which one is the right one, and then we switch to the right one. I'm gonna just switch to the video. Okay. You can see the estimated current here in the case where there is a known current, and on the left where the case is the known current. So as we start from the right location, as the vehicle moves and it's going on a circumference, it immediately finds that, okay, this was not the right model I was starting with. I have to switch back to the other one. And here, at the same time, we are finding the location of the beacon and the location of the vehicle. So it's a kind of a slam that we are doing. Okay, so I would go back to the slides. Okay. So up to this point, what I said was just observability. Observability in this sense was a deterministic case. So I looked at the problem in a deterministic scenario. It's a yes or no answer. So either my system is observable or it's not. But what about going for some qualitative measure? So what is the achievable accuracy of the any unbiased estimator if we have this much of information? And how can we characterize the trajectories that would yield maximum information for us? So there are some theoretical and practical challenges. We first start with the main question that, given the initial location of the vehicle, what are the best sequence of actions here, the headings for the vehicle that can maximize the information about the target location? So we can go for two different measures of information. There is the empirical observability Gramian or Fisher information matrix. These two are closely related to each other. But the Fisher information is basically a Kramer lower bound, which is going to give you the upper bound on the covariance matrix, the lower bound on the covariance matrix. So if we try to drive the Fisher information matrix based on the log likelihood function of the measurement model that we have, and then try to maximize this information, this would give us a trajectory that would yield the maximum fissure. So in this case, we can, for the single beacon case, we can analytically find the optimal fissure information matrix, which is nothing but the outer product of the relative location of the vehicle with respect to the beacon, and then sum it up and multiply it by the uncertainty you have on the sensor. And then if we can also find the optimal fissure, which is nothing but a constant value multiplied by the identity matrix. And these are some examples of the trajectory which will give you the maximum information, like going around the beacon, just containing the beacon, or even something like close to the square motion around the vehicle would even give you maximum information. So putting this result that we got on top of a moving target that is slowly moving, here the target is moving, I think, with 0.2 meters per second, and having the knowledge about just the velocity of the target, we can put a circular motion on top of this motion, which is going to be a spiral motion. And here we have just, at each time, we have a window of six samples, and then 6 seconds between the samples. And this would give us the maximum information we can get from this set of sensors and the vehicle. But we shouldn't just jump on this on the case that there is an unknown current, since if we just formulate the same thing on the case of unknown currents, then the results are going to be catastrophic. And as you can see, the surface vehicle is doing completely crazy maneuvers, trying to replicate something which is not intended to do. I think I'm running out of time. I would just give you some experiments with the same notion. And I would just describe the setup. So in this setup, there are three medusa vehicles, there are two medusa vehicles, sorry, that one is under the water running at 0.2 meters per second at a constant depth of 1 meter. Then every 1.5 second you get single range from the underwater to the surface vehicle. And the surface vehicle is equipped with GPS, so it can do path following with that GPS. And the other thing is that the target is sending its velocity, since we still don't know about the unknown current case scenario. And with this information, we do a sequential algorithm where we predict the target parameters, speed and position. Then we obtain the tracker optimal speed and optimal course rate based on what we derived before. And then we implement the control law for the tracker to follow the tracker based on the optimal speed and course rate that it got before. And then after this, we get the measurement, and then we estimate the target, and we do this sequentially over the loop. This is what it's gonna look like at the end. I would switch to the video here. So here you can just see a replica of the logs gathered from the vehicles, that the lower vehicle is just following a mission with a very low speed of 0.2 meters per second, and the upper one is just going around the vehicle, try to maximize the information about the source, and at the same time following it. And okay, so I would stop this one. And if you want more information, you can look at the publication for this case. So I would just close this by just some lesson I learned from these years. First of all, acoustic localization or communication is not so trivial in water. There is multipass, there are misses, there are delays, and the communication bandwidth is quite low. So you have to make the most of information that you can get. So every single information that you get underwater, you have to take into account. Then it's also worth look deeper into your problem. So try to find the main cause. What is, why the problem is happening? And then in this case, for example, for us, the observability analysis helped us in designing a new estimator, which was specifically working, and we could try to switch between two different hypotheses based on what we got before. And one more thing is that do not underestimate the waterproofing. The last thing you want is water in your sensitive, you know, electronics or even mechanical parts of the UMV. And there is good news also that the acoustic modems are evolving, and we are seeing a lot of new acoustic modems. The bandwidths are increasing, the ranges are becoming better, outlier rejection is working more and more better, and yeah, there is hope. Yeah, thank you very much.
Thanks for the presentation. I was wondering what is the bonus of the accuracy compared to GPS in the case of underwater? That may be a stupid question, but I don't know, because you're using GPS when you're making the ground. So why would you want to use accuracy?
So many of the examples I gave here was proof of concept, let's say. So it's more to our research-oriented applications. So when you're doing research, you first want to compare your result based on something which is the best case scenario, in this case the GPS. So from the GPS you get some ground truths, and then you compare your algorithm with the ground truths to see, okay, was I performing fine or not? How was my accuracy? So it's kind of the baseline there. And yet, if you go underwater, the GPS doesn't work. Okay. That's just it. You know, the electromagnetic signal doesn't penetrate under the water. So that's what, you know, mammals are doing, like the dolphins are doing under the water. Yeah.
Well, so maximum you can reach with this setup?
It really depends on the vehicle. So in the vehicles that I showed you, so those vehicles can go up to 20 meters underwater. But if you want to go deeper, you have to design your vehicle specifically for that specific case scenario. Like the same vehicle can be strengthened, so you have to change the material. You have to go for aluminium casing or even titanium to go to like 1,000 meters, 2,000 meters. Or even there are AUVs, ROVs now working up to 6,000 or 7,000 meters deep in the ocean. So it really depends on what's your application and how much budget you have.
I have a question, not super related to your talk. You had a heat map on, it was slide 41 to 45.
Yes.
What was that heat map of? Did I miss it or?
That was, there are different heat maps we have. One of them is just, you know, the depth of the location.
Okay.
So how deep it is. And some of them are even the magnetic field in that location, because there are even navigation methods based on the magnetic field at each location.
I have some questions. So your work clearly is taking account that you've got waves, you know, which is different than ground robots, because all of a sudden it's like, oh, look, I've changed maybe, you know, 3 meters in my altitude, which GPS is not particularly good at catching. Mm-hmm. That's the change. So you have the impact of waves and weather and current on your vehicles. And you need a little bit of that with the estimators. But how do you test? How do you can't really control the waves and weather when you go outside. How do you do that?
I would say that you probably don't try to control the waves. You try to tackle the waves the same way as they are doing. So if the wave is coming to you, I wouldn't say I would try to like try to go against it. I would try to embrace it, let's say. So if the wave is going up and down, okay, let's try not to put much pressure. Let's also go up and down. It's not that much of a problem. Since you already have the sensors on board, for example, the vehicles could have like DVL, or like pressure sensors to compensate for going up and down. And I would say I would try to get the information that I have and try to localize myself, or I know, control myself, even though if I have the current. So I would consider it as a sort of a disturbance to the system and just face it as it is and just embrace it, I would say.
How do you test that to show reproducible results? I mean, it seems like you would either get, or when we go out, it's either always too flat or too stormy.
That's true, yeah. Some of the AUVs or ROVs that are built, they are not designed to work in such a harsh environment. So if you have a very strong wave or wind, even the thrusters of the vehicles are not strong enough that they can handle that much of effect. So they cannot just do it. So it's like the example you gave before. The vehicle is going forward. I mean, thinking it's going forward, but it's basically going forward, backward, because its thrusters are, even the thrusters are not big enough that can handle that much of a wave or current, or they're not pushing that much force into their thrusters.
I have a little different take on it. So are you looking at the weather and saying, next week there's going to be waves, and so
yeah,
we're going to test that?
Yes.
This week is going to be flat nuisance, taking everything out in the water.
Do you try
to predict that for how you actually set up the testing regime?
Yeah, in these cases, since these are all, you know, research-based scenarios, we normally avoid to go to the water if there are strong waves or strong winds, because we are not yet, let's say, in these cases, we have to take the steps one by one. So we first try to do it in a more controlled environment. It's a still open sea, but it's still open water, but we go first into the water where the waves are smaller or the currents are smaller, and then let's take it a bit further and go to the more harsh environment, let's say.
Any other questions?
Thank you for the guide. So I want to know what kind of information you use for the localization, like TDOA or TOF or DOA?
In these cases, it depends what is the... So you could have like just acoustic modems. Those modems depends on the modem. Some of the modems, since they don't have synchronized clocks, so they do either, you know, both going and coming time of arrival, and some of them they do time difference of arrival. But according to the, you know, there are some recent technologies that you can have atomic clocks in a very reasonable size that you can embed it in the modems. So you can have synchronized modems. Based on that, you can just do time of arrival. So you just do a ping, and then you just look at when was the time received, and you already know when it was sent. Yeah.
All right. Well, thank you very much. Appreciate
yeah.
Okay. It.
Thank
we're
you.
We're seeing if the coffee break is set up. If it is, since we're writing the coffee break, we take the coffee break now and just catch our invited speakers' short talks after the coffee break. But if it's not set up, because since everything is running a little bit slow today or off kilter, then we'll go to our 5-minute talks. So we're waiting for Mel to get back. Yeah, he went to chat and should be back shortly. So far, are you excited? Are you going to change your research to unmanned marine vehicles? Or are you now like, this is hard and terrifying? But you guys even talk about how salt water is corrosive on top of it.
I was going to say, I bet you go to some interesting test sites.
A lot of mosquitoes for us in Texas. But you've been testing over in Portugal. It's one of the most beautiful beaches in the world.
Balance and device. Balance and device.
Florida is better.
I like it. I'll check what kind of email
it is.
Send someone in 5 minutes. Oh, there he is. So, 5 minutes.
Sandeep, are you comfortable presenting now? Or do you want to be the presenters you have?
We do one talk and then go through the others.
John, do you mind presenting persons for you? And you know how to swap. So, we're going to go now. We're going to reverse the order. I know Jan's presentation is already loaded, it's a little stress off. Jan's been going graduate with students and he's been working on the idea of the US data prototype. So I'm going to launch him down and control him, thinking about how to control him or whatever. So. Okay, maybe, yeah, let me get over there. I can find where all the problems are. 300,000.
Sorry. Didn't mean to.
Okay, so your talk's right there. And we can go to the entire screen. So that puts you there. And if you want, I'll find your talk or your video.
Okay. Well,
so if you want to, I'll do your slides for you if you tell me. Or you can.
Hello, everybody. My name is Jan Dufek, and I'm a PhD student of Dr. Murphy from Texas A&M University. And I would like to quickly present my research and also to focus on what are some of the challenges. So my research is to use UAV to visually navigate USV to victims, which are selected by the operator in the video feed. Which is useful to responders because it adds autonomy, so they don't need to teleoperate the USV, and they can focus on rescuing. So some of the assumptions or observations we have made: our operation radius is about 180 meters. There are usually no obstacles. USV it can move very fast, up to 35 kilometers per hour. So our visual tracking needs to be robust to the speed of USV. Our UAV is tethered because we need as robust control as possible, so that we don't need a person who needs to constantly operate a UAV. So tethered UAV can be operated from a boat or from a shore. And because of the UAV is tethered, we have a video under oblique angle because it's not directly above victims. And UAV has only visual camera because it's the cheapest option, and every UAV has visual camera, and we are working with no GPS. I would like to expand on this. The reason we are not using GPS is because we don't need global coordinates. We just need relative position of USV to the victims. And since victims are selected in the video, we don't even know global positions of victims. And to do this, we are using camshift algorithm on hue histogram back projection to get position of USV. And then we are using Douglas Puker curve approximation on location history to get orientation. And from position and orientation, we can use PID controller to compute radar commands to get USV to the victims. So some of the challenges we had with this project kind of be divided into three categories. The first are environmental challenges, and those. Let me start with lightning. Lightning is a problem for all visual algorithms, and in this particular case, the lightning can change not only depending on the time of the day, but it can also change during one mission because USV can go from shadows to sun. And it also depends on the relative position of the camera, sun, and USV. And it can happen that if USV is in the shadow, its color may desaturate to the color of the environment, especially the water, which is very challenging. The second are waves, because waves can cause USV to drift. And the third is wind, and wind can cause UAV to drift. The second class of problems stems from oblique view, which we have, and we are mostly having perspective problems because since we are not looking from the top, the apparent motion of USV in the horizontal axis appears to be greater than the apparent motion in the axis which is vertical. So it's very hard to recognize vertical motion in the image. So it might look like USV is not moving, but in fact it's moving. And also the apparent motion in the video does not correspond to the, or it's not constant to the real motion. So if it's further away, it appears to be slower. And the last class of problem is movement, because since our algorithm for position estimation is based on location history, if the UAV is moving, we are getting lots of noise to the location. Our algorithm tries to smooth it, but if the movement is big or the UAV is drifting, the algorithm will think that it's not UAV motion, but it's USV motion, and this can cause some problems. So let me quickly switch to the video, and I will show you demo of our algorithm. So this is the experiment we did in Lake Bryan in Texas. So as you can see, the operator selected MLA and choose target. And now our algorithm is tracking USV. In this case, USV is MLA Dr. Murphy talked about previously. We can see the location history approximation in purple line, and the green crosshair are location. And we can see that PID controller drives MLA to the target. So right now you can see that it's coming towards us. So the motion, apparent motion in the image slows down, even though MLA is moving in constant speed. And now it reached the target. Okay, thank you for your attention.
Any quick questions for you?
Have you thought about putting the aerial device to the equipment or the
to the equipment? To the USV?
To the USV.
No, we actually didn't do this because since there will be like many problems, like with for example, base station isn't waterproof, and so we didn't actually do that.
Yeah, we had looked at that. That doesn't seem to be a good fit, particularly if you want to run it 35 kilometers per hour dragging a UAV. Seems a bit of a challenge, as well as adding a way to change it. So it is on the list. The manufacturer is very interested in it, but it's very practical on that direction.
It will increase the range. You can use the road, right?
Right, but if you only need to use it in a 180-meter bubble, which is what most lifeguards would be using for, that's the standard as close as you can get. And why make it do more? You start losing. Look how small the image is. So it seems like you're trading on problems. It'd be great in a situation where it's, because right now the camera is right in the nose of the. So it's a water view, so it has a higher view. Other questions?
How do you think of scaling it up in a bigger region, like more visible against?
It all depends on how far can you see with the camera. It of course depends on field of view and the resolution. In the case it's very far, then a visual representation of USV in the image will be very small. So then we have actually tried it, and then, for example, USV might be represented only by, let's say, like 6 pixels or very small. So it's still work, but you have less information. So it's not that accurate.
Can you think of using multiple vehicles to track, like using multiple cameras or?
No, so far we have worked just with one UAV.
I've looked at that, and I've also looked at, we've done experiments with a free flying untethered UAV. You're talking about extra manpower, where you launch and land into some of these things. So we've got this one with the tethered UAV. All right, well, if there are no more, we're good. Are you still waiting?
Good.
Okay. Okay, well, let's thank the presenter. Let's take our coffee break and be back here at 4 o'clock.
You need that piece. Just give it.
Hang on a minute, I'll get it out. Here we go. Yeah, you definitely don't want to stop the broadcast. Good. Let's move that out of the way. What are you looking for? Start closing some of these since we don't need. Okay, so which one is that, yours?
Yeah.
Thanks for being brave, Sandy.
Okay, I just have a link. It's a convenient one of the process. Can I enter on Firefox or Chrome is good?
Use Firefox. Please don't use Chrome right now. I don't want to mess up Google. So you don't want to just move over the physical files or use that?
Why aren't you just using
the physical
files? Because the videos are, my animations aren't working on
so
there.
So you know you'll have to shift to the,
Yeah.
And I can set that, I can stretch your decision.
I just want to test it once. Okay, it's working.
Oh, great.
That's working. Two.
Okay. Super.
I have to, I'll just need like 10 to 12 minutes. 10 minutes, maybe.
Yes, everybody's supposed to be 5. So,
okay, I can go fast over some of these because
they're short. That'll be great. Sure. Thanks. 7 minutes.
Okay. Including questions. That's good.
That's good.
I'll leave it there.
Yeah, we can leave it there and I'll get everybody back up. And
can you check if you can share the Firefox? It's a good present mode.
Looks like it.
Okay. This is that.
We just did that, so
okay,
I'm going to go back.
Okay, sure.
I'm going to go back to the.
Sound good, right?
Yeah, you're good. I'm going to go back to this and share that.
Okay, what is the link to see the video? I don't see it. Is it on the?
It's now on this right here. If you go to the SSRR.
On the workshop, right?
Yeah. Thanks. Great. Thanks.
Nice meeting you.
Yeah, it makes it so much more stressful with all these changes and everything. That's a good change. Greg and I have been good friends for that.
Yes, he put into some of the papers, and that's how I'm doing. Yeah, I did my sister with Greg and I'm doing my PhD with him.
Only two people. All right.
Okay. Coffee?
Yes.
So. Thank you.
Get back to work. All right, we're almost back. I know we said we'd be back at 4. People are wandering in. That's the problem. We have good coffee and great muffins, and everybody's getting a chance to talk with each other. So we're there. So we'll start shortly, and we'll go back to Sandeep, have him present, then Eleni, and then we'll go into the breakout sessions. Post a little later as a report, so stay tuned for that, but that will be after the workshop is over. Right, people still moving in. Seems 50-50 between coffee and orange juice, whether we're going with caffeine or sugar to deal with the different time changes. Both are good and valuable. Well, let's go ahead and get started. And our next short talk is going to be by Sandeep Manjanna from McGill University in Canada. That group's comes up with interesting projects in water-based systems that are not in Canada, not Arctic ice fishing and things like that. So we'll see this presentation, and
that gives us a reason to go to nice places.
Indeed, it's a very well thought out. I think Greg is a very forward-thinking person.
I think it's in the same one. You can just share the five folks.
Okay.
Yeah.
There we go. All right, and so take it away. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Murphy. Okay. Hi, everyone. I'm Sandeep Manjanna. I'm a PhD candidate at McGill University. I'm presenting an algorithm for multi-robot path planning for search and rescue, marine robotics, marine environments. My collaborators are Malika Meghjani and Nikhil Kakodkar. We work with Professor Dudek, as Professor Murphy already mentioned. So basically, what is the motivation? So one of the motivational examples is we have these drifting sensor nodes, which you can see on the right side of the screen. Those are the nodes which collect data, and you'll leave them drifting in water for a while, maybe for a few days, and then you want to go and collect them. So you have a surface vehicle which plans its path and goes and collects these drifters, either collect them physically or collect the data from those drifters. Do our experiments, field experiments. So that is the reason you see on the right hand side. The reason we work, at least for this experiment, we worked in a 100 meter by 75 meter range. And you have a lot of waves, and I can show you pictures later. So basically, if you have a region and you want to cover it, one of the naive ways is to go for a lawnmower pattern and cover the whole entire region. But as you can see, like, we had to do multiple runs to cover this small region because of the battery and other operational issues. So this is not what we need. We want to have something which is more live, it's not being telecasted. Okay. Okay. Should I present from here?
Maybe try full screen.
Full screen. Able to see?
Yeah, I mean, it's showing the entire screen.
Ah, okay. Yeah, I'll just do that. Sorry. So, share the entire screen.
That's the slide, Google Slides.
Sure. Is it good? No.
There you go.
It's good. Okay. Okay. So basically, the problem is it causes delays in the target search, and you don't want to lose these drifting targets. And also, it's more inefficient. So we designed a planning algorithm, which is a reward-driven anytime offline algorithm, which gives a, I think it's not running still. Oh, it's slow, okay. Planning algorithm, which is reward-based. So we used, basically we used reinforcement learning to come up with a plan for every step the robot takes. So when you're searching for a target, you have some small idea about the underlying distribution, where the target might be. Because if you can just think of a Gaussian with the mean at the last location where you saw the target, then that gives you a particular distribution of the region under the underlying distribution. So you can use that distribution. And what we are doing is that we are using the distribution, and each grid is given a value based on the expected value for the drifter to be there, and then we use that reward to guide the robot to go and search in that particular grid. So what we do is we take a step, we conduct the value iteration gives you an action, and you take the action and you clear the reward from previous cell, so that you don't do a to and fro motion between the two cells. You want to go ahead. So what this helps us is, as you can see in this video, okay, this is the simulation result where you see the robot moving to higher rewarding regions. Red is higher rewarding and blue is lower rewarding. So the gradient is between red and blue. And you go to all higher rewarding regions. And then, as you can see, in the lower rewarding regions, the steps are bigger. So you don't have to take very small steps when you have low rewarding regions, because you don't have chance of finding the target. So you take bigger steps. But higher rewarding regions has more chances of finding the target. So you take smaller steps to be more careful. This algorithm is anytime algorithm is an algorithm which gives you an optimal solution whenever you stop it, because we are going for the optimal higher information gain. Anytime you stop it in whatever region it has covered, it gives you the higher information in that region. And also one more important feature of this algorithm is it's a mixed resolution sampling. As you can see, higher rewarding, higher information regions are sampled with higher resolution, and lower rewarding are sampled with lower resolution. And one more important feature is doing a value iteration for every step is really expensive, considering the whole state space, like considering the whole grid region. So what we are doing is we just consider few neighbors around the robot's current position, and do the value iteration only with that particular state space. So going to next one. Okay, how do you expand this into multi-robot case? We decided to use a mixture of distributed decision making and also but full communication. That is, like, you have a full communication and every robot knows about the other robot's position, but each robot is taking decision based on its own computations. there's no centralized system which is giving instructions to all the robots. So basically what we did is, if you are in a particular grid cell and you have a grid cell which is closer to you and which is farther from everyone else, then the reward of that grid cell is higher for the current robot. And if some grid cell is farther from me, and if it is closer to some other person, some other robot B, then that robot has higher reward for that particular grid cell. So that robot covers that particular region, and I cover the region which is closer to me. So we included this into the reward function, and then the value iteration algorithm takes care of it by itself. So as you can see in the simulation, like three robots covering three different regions. So they stick on to the region which is closer to them. But as time goes ahead, as you can see, I'll just go a bit further. And there you see red and black are interfering in each other, and now red goes to white's region. So once the region is covered, you want to expand. But if the battery of one of the robots is over, then the other robot takes care of the remaining region. So that is the beauty of the algorithm. And in field trials, I give you one example that is to find these targets. Same algorithm can be used for other application, like covering the coral reefs. So here what we did is, we did a raster scan of whole region with a depth sensor. And what you see on the left hand side is the depth map. So red being shallower and blue being deeper. So we, in our lab, we are more interested in mapping the coral reefs and monitoring the coral reefs. So what we do is, shallower the region, there is more good video data you can get from the surface. And deeper the region, your video is not useful. So we want to take more video of the shallow region. And also, the shallow region means protruding corals, and deeper regions are most of them are sands. So using that information, we use the same algorithm to give us a path which takes us only through the coral reef and does not cover the sand. So this is the real data from Barbados, the region I showed you before. And you see two coral heads, one on the top right and one on the left bottom. So the robot chose to go cover the first one and then cover the next one. Yeah. And the right-hand side is the actual path trajectory followed by the robot. The curves are due to the controller errors, which cannot turn non-holonomic constraints. And one more important thing I just added while sitting here, because people were interested in this, we did include the effect of wind on the robot's trajectory. So if the robot is, if the wind direction is from right to left, you would don't want any trajectories which is perpendicular to the wind direction. You put more cost on the paths which are perpendicular, and you give more priority for the paths which are parallel to the wind direction. So that we can include in the reward function too. So based on your prediction, whatever is there for the day, you update your reward function, you update your wind speed, and using the wind speed, your reward will be changed, and you get different paths every day when you do the monitoring. So variant search strategy, we combine this particular strategy with spiral search, and this is the paper. We have it in this conference on 26th at 2 p.m. So if you're interested in learning more about this, please come to the session and I'll be talking about that. So this is a very cool, interesting idea where we merge data-independent spiral search with reinforcement learning, and we come up with a new strategy to look for multiple targets. And I thank the team. This is the MRL, Mobile Robotics Lab team in Barbados. So we go in January when it's really cold in Canada, and we go there and we hang out there and have fun with the experiments. Yeah. Okay, that's it. If you have any questions, please.
Any questions?
You had answered the question I had, which was about the controller. We see very hard that they're not, surface vehicles are not holonomic vehicles.
Yes.
Extremely.
Well, I mean, I can, I did think of that and tried considering having, limiting your actions than just going for east, west, north, south, going to northeast. That gives you more non-holonomic paths. Mm-hmm. But I'm sure the work is in the progress.
Great. Well, thank you. Okay.
Thank you. Thank you.
All right. And all right. And our next speaker from Norway is here. And let's get you set up. I know. Let's see. Where's the folder? Yes, let's get your folder. Everybody's named.
Yeah.
Okay, great. And so you see right
at this point. We don't need the videos. It's sufficient just to go through the presentation, so I don't need to switch.
Great. Well, besides the videos. And what we'll do now is screen share too. We do entire screen. And thank you. It's very exciting to have this type of work in much more different platforms. So thank you.
Hello. As you can see, my name is Eleni, and I work with underwater snake robots, which is cool, in my opinion. But in this presentation, I will not show our work for in underwater robotics. The purpose of this presentation is to show the potential of using underwater bio-inspired swimming snake robots for different subsea operations. And I will start with the case that nowadays there is increasing interest, and as we can see from the workshop also, to use underwater robots for several applications. For instance, there is a need to use for resource extraction, and oil and gas industry is the biggest user so far. In the science, in oceanography, ocean engineering, and several other reasons. For national defense, for instance, in underwater communication, search and detection. In telecommunication, there has been several robots being used, like ROVs is constantly being used there, in construction and inspection, and lately in archaeology and search and recovery. So we can see that there is a huge increasing need to use underwater robotics because for many reasons, because this operation has been done in dirty, dangerous, distant, and dual environment. So we don't need there humans, we don't need to people, divers, to operate, for instance, in areas where it's really deep water, where we can't send divers under ice or in nuclear plant. So we can see that there is a need to not operate in dangerous environment. And the main goal is to not have a man on seabed or in surface. This is the one purpose, use underwater robots, risk having people there. And the other one, that's, we can, I think it's better now. Okay, and the other one is to reduce the cost. To send us big ROVs, employ them, and to operate in environment, in underwater environment, it's quite costly. So we need smaller robots, more efficient, and less cost. Okay. But then there is several operations that should be done by using underwater robotics. I have listed some of them here. There is more and more to be added as operations, and we can see that all these operations cannot be done from any only one type of robots, which means that we need to build several types of underwater robots that can be used for different applications. And then the huge gap is that we need to do more research. We need to bring more research results and end up having new robotics systems. So to look in the future, we are not saying that, you know, with the new robots, we will stop using ROVs. ROVs, we can't stop using them, or IOVs. So what we want is to, for heavy intervention tasks, we will still have big ROVs, which will be occupied with manipulators in order to do heavy intervention tasks. Another approach would be to have autonomous underwater vehicles where they are not tethered, you don't need an operator, and we can occupy this with manipulator arms as the intervention ROVs that has been studied lately. Another approach that the research in underwater robotics goes towards is to use subsea resident vehicles. We don't need all the time that we need something to be done underwater to send robots there. We would like to have them permanently installed there, and when the task needs to be done, then the robot will be activated automatically. It's not science fiction, we are leading there. And another case is to get inspiration from the biology. So to build bio-inspired solutions which can be cheaper, smaller, and do inspection and light intervention tasks. And here it comes, the snake robots. So the idea is to bring new type of bio-inspired, flexible, maneuverable swimming snake robots and have a swarm of them permanently installed underwater environment and to do different operations. So the idea here is to, as I said, to get inspired from the biology, both with regards to the shape of the robot, also the locomotion capabilities, to make a robotic system that can be more efficient by getting inspiration from the biological swimmers. So we can have a snake robot multi-degrees robotic system, occupy them with different effectors, can be fins, can be thrusters. We can have a cameras if we need to have an inspection tasks, or we can have tool, intervention tool, if we needed to do some intervention, light intervention tasks. Because the body of the robotic, the snake robot, it is a manipulator by itself. So you don't need a robot that you will need to extra to add a manipulation. But the body can act like this and can do several manipulation tasks in the underwater environment. So our group is studying underwater robots in several different ways. And my presentation here is not to show you what we have done. My presentation here is to bring you of using new type of robots for underwater inspection or intervention tasks. And tomorrow in the plenary, my supervisor, Christine Pedersen, will give the background of our research and the results. Thank you very much.
Any questions?
Maybe a practical question, maybe we'll discover it tomorrow, but how can you do manipulation with the accuracy of it, manipulation with one end effector and the whole body behind? What type of maneuvers can you do in manipulation?
For instance, I show here some different type of operations we can see, right? I would see that we can do plug and plug, unplug some connectors, which is really easy, light interventions. You don't need to send an ROV and have to deploy all the vessel with an operator. So these things, or like turn a valve when it's needed, or to which kind of other operations, like to recover something or cut something, to move a cable or give information. So if you have several of them, they may also collaborate on doing something more, not that light interventions, but it's all concepts that we are, the main challenge in this case, it's not what type of intervention we can do, it's that how the base can be attached somewhere. So we can actually use the tool on the head to do this type of interventions. And that's why we're also studying like this DP systems to see how the base can be stationary, and then the end effector as a normal regular manipulator can do this kind of small interventions.
Maybe I'll follow up you. As with a snake robot, you are redundant, so you have an interesting problem. Part of the body should be there for locomotion and stabilization, and the rest, I guess, for the manipulation. But I guess it's a very interesting research question. How to do this optimally?
Yeah, as we will see tomorrow, it's that the new generation of the snakes that we're building in our group, they are occupied also with thrusters, which means that the thrusters are used to do to keep the stationary keeping of the base of the body, and then you use the body undulation to do different type of tasks. So there is coupling between them, how you can combine the marine research from thrusters and the bio-inspired locomotion types to combine these things and solve the problem.
So as a follow-up to that, it sounds like, you know, one of the technological advances is basically to reduce the marine snake or the marine manipulation problem to a ground robot manipulation problem, mobile manipulation. So once you have the thrusters in, you now have a fixed base and you're back to just manipulate objects. I mean, manipulation is a huge hard problem. But now you can use ground techniques developed for ground robots because you've solved
the problem with where to stay.
Okay. Cool.
But it's not that easy as it says. It's quite challenging because we are really, really in an environment where we need to get input on so many uncertainties. But it's something that it's cool to study, and we have some results as we will see tomorrow.
Great. Well, thank you.
Yeah.
Well, that concludes the talk portion of this, and now it's the talk amongst ourselves portion that we're going to go to.
Since we're going to shift back to well, we did have a screen that had all of our, oh, that's right. Sorry. And so now we're a few minutes behind, but we're gonna do breakout groups. And so the idea is for each of you to pick a group that you wanna be in. One's gonna focus on vehicles and manipulators. Another's going to focus on the human-robot interaction. Another group's going to focus on the sensor, sensing, data visualization. And we've got three rooms, this room and two other rooms upstairs. And we have assigned scribes. I'm going to introduce them in a minute. Assigned scribes that'll take notes, but we need you to self-organize and pick a leader of the group to try to bring back the important issues that are needed for a roadmap. What are the hard challenges? Which challenges should be done first? That sort of thing. So really what we're looking at is what type of roadmap can we come up with? What would you want to see happen? We need radical changes in the physical hardware? We need radical improvements in sensors. Are the sensors probably there, but we need better algorithms? Is the fact that, you know, underwater communications is greatly limited, is how does that impact data visualization? Is there something different? So we want you to work on that and then come back and report out. So let me first off stop the broadcast.